involved Great Britain's Lady Diana. But I tell you, her gold does not come in the form of records or in the New York City office of a superstar. Bill Harris here. We've traveled from Hollywood to meet a lady who for years has been worshipped by millions as their own personal Lady Diana. This month, Showtime is proud to present an exclusive, live, coast-to-coast, a concert that's destined to become a show business landmark. Outside this window, in a little patch of green known as Central Park, none other than Diana Ross will perform live in a free concert that should be a show business landmark. Performing and producing, as many as 1 million people may be in that audience for a free concert that Showtime will air right here live on Thursday, July 21st. You're going to be appearing before as many as 1 million people, and this is the same girl who dropped out of a vocal class once upon a time because she was afraid she was going to get a D?
Well, I didn't want to get a bad grade, so, and that was a different kind of music than the music we do. That was real discipline, kind of music in that school choir.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that it would be better for me if I was going to take an elective for me to get a good grade and not a bad one.
And so we turned out, in fact, you never had lessons then as a result, did
No,
you?
I never had any singing lessons, no.
What taught you the joy? When people are in a Diana Ross audience, it isn't just you up there clapping hands. They join you. They want to be there. You don't lead them into it. They follow you.
You know, I don't... The thing that works well for me on from stage to the audience is for me to have a one-to-one relationship with them rather than my being separate from them.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like as soon as I walk on the stage, we're really in it together. It's like we're into this thing together. And most people are responsible for their own happiness. They come to have a good time. So going in, when I walk on the stage, I know that these people are here to have pleasure. So they're not coming to sit and have a bad time. They want to mm-hmm. have a good time. And all I have to do is give them the best that I know how to give them. And already they're fans, otherwise they wouldn't be there. The skeptics, the ones are coming to judge the show.
Sure.
Usually at the beginning of the show, I say, all right, for those of you that have your arms folded, I want you to unfold your arms and just relax. And one of the first couple of songs that I do is reach out and touch. And it's a funny thing about touching, and well, it's a lovely thing, actually, because as people start holding hands and opening up, after reach out and touch, you can almost phone the show in. Everybody's already having a good time.
Yeah.
You know, and they're relaxed. And I always tell them that it's up to them to have a good time. And I'll give them the best that I know how.
Mm. When I speak about the fact you're in front of 500,000 people or more in Central Park, solo spotlight, and I think back to those days when you were backing up some of the Motown artists, what's the different feeling what's the feeling between being behind the artist and being the artist? How'd you feel as a backup when the real star is in front of you?
Oh, that was all right.
It was okay, too?
See, the work, you know, to me, you still have to be supportive, no matter whether I'm out there by myself. I have to support my orchestra. We become a team.
Mm-hmm.
So I think when I was backing up Marvin Gaye and Marv Johnson and some of the acts that were singing back at that time, they were my teachers because I was watching them closely. And we would always be the opening act in concerts or if we went out on a Motown review. But I'd watch Smokey Robinson, he was the closing act. I'd watch what he did to make an audience. And there was a group at Motown at that time called the Contours, and they used to get the audience a little bit softer now,
mm-hmm.
a little bit softer. And I used to do that. I would go on my own concert and I'll steal that one and make it work. So they taught me. I mean, I just learned from Smokey so much. I mean, this show, the Motown 25th, was a love-in for us. I just hope the audience out there can feel the relationship between all the people there and how we felt about Barry and just all the other groups, Martha Rees and the Vandellas. And our roads have changed so much. I mean, everybody's gone in different directions, and I think that's what life is. Everybody, you know, we move around. I live in New York now. I've left Detroit. Motown's in California. And everybody's all over you know, we've spread out. Everybody's grown up. But it's exciting when we all got back together. It was really just like a love-in. Everybody
again.
Was kissing and hugging. And
great feeling.
It was very exciting.
We've discussed the fact that during interviews over the years, every now and then, and very frequently, in fact, to be honest, perhaps the wrong things, the wrong quotes have been written. And I want to know if this was a real one. When you first met Barry Gordy, who had founded Motown, you finally, after pestering him, I'm told, got a job as his secretary, and you wrote, I couldn't type or take shorthand, but I kept his desk real nice and straight.
This is true, yeah. Well, so I don't think he needed a secretary.
Okay. Not then.
He wanted a girl behind the desk or something.
Yep. And that led to the Primettes becoming the Supremes.
I guess, you know, we had come to the company as the Primettes, and we were trying to do a little background work, and it was a very, see, if you were to see this company right now, it's still in Detroit as a, like a little museum. It's called Hitsville, USA. Now, we talk about it like it's this monumental, this big place, but it's one little room. It's a little room and a little front room, and it's so tiny. Even when I go back there to realize, you know, it was like a world. So I did. I was very secretary, and I was still in school, and I remember I had an art class or something, and I made these cufflinks for him. But I guess I won him over by being so kind to him, because the truth is, I wasn't a secretary. I couldn't type or take shorthand or anything.
He said you were like a young deer, didn't he?
Yeah, he said that for a long time. In fact, when he bought a beautiful home in California, and he would have lots of animals, which he loves a lot, and he bought a little doe, and he called it Diana. But I don't know what he meant by that. I'm pretty wild.
It sounds wonderful to me.
I love to run. See, I know what he was talking about. I'm very fast. I used to be a sprinter, and I used to run all the time. And so, you know, it's fast, and I think it's skinny.
Sleek.
Okay.
Sleek.
I'll take that.
When we're looking back, I realized that once the Primettes became the Supremes, and we have 9 records out, and still not a hit. What were the Supremes? They were just sort of missing until Where Did Our Love Go, 1964?
Yeah. I guess, I don't know how many records we had. I've lost track now. How many we had out before that first record? Smokey wrote most of our records. One, Are You Just a Breathtaking First Sight Soul Shaking One Night Love Making Guy? Then there was one called Let Me Go the Right Way. We had When the Love Light Shines Through His Eyes. Nobody remember all these songs.
You do, that's enough. Did you know when you had Where Did Our Love Go?
We happened at that time to be on a Dick Clark tour. And we were on the tour basically as a filler. We were not one of the hit record groups. I think there was, I don't know who was on that first tour. I've been on a lot of Dick Clark tours, and Loving Spoonfuls, and, you know, so many of the groups, the Shirelles. But at that time, we were not very popular. And as the tour went on, people started recognizing us as we came on the stage, yeah. And Dick started moving us closer and closer to the end of the show.
No fool, he. And as you get closer to the end of the show, you know that the bigger and the bigger you're getting.
The records are selling.
Well, some people do forget that you had those couple years of records that didn't quite make it, but after that, there was never any looking back. I mean big. If people, for the 10 people out there who don't know how big Diana Ross and the Supremes are, I'm never going to be able to tell you. The gold records are everywhere here in the office.
Yes, they were a gift to me. That was really good. It was very difficult for us, though. Young girls right out of high school. My mother traveled with us as a chaperone. It was quite difficult. My daughter is singing now, and she understands that it was, you know, to try to sing while you're in school, you have to get your homework and get your schoolwork, and parents really don't let you go halfway. But my mother was very supportive of my singing career. And so she traveled with us, I think it was so hard on us that we never really stayed at home very much. And when everybody else was out having parties and going to college, we were on the road.
And proms, and all the normal.
Yeah, we were doing the other things. And it was difficult because you can't really have boyfriends, and it makes life quite difficult.
One of the things that I love in researching is a show called Hep.
Like Hep.
Which was hosted by Diana Shore.
And Lucille Ball.
Oh, see, Lucille Ball, I could understand being hep, but Diana, I just felt...
It was wonderful. It was all a switch of the 3 girls, and they played they played like they were the Supremes in one segment, and that was really kind of... The man who produced that and directed that was just a genius. His name is George Slaughter.
Sure,
and he's
been
able to help me so much in my career about humor and being funny, because I like that a lot, you know.
The man behind laughing,
yeah,
too.
He's wonderful.
Yeah. When you go out in public, I've seen the way people treat you. Do you have an incognito outfit, one that lets you just kind of sneak around without people knowing Diana Ross is right next to you?
No, I never do.
You don't?
No, I don't do that, because to me, if I were to costume myself to be somebody other than I am, then I'm telling a lie.